How does my hair look? Like a beast? Good.
Don't try to run, don't try to hide. You steal your car without thinking twice. Stop the party, hide your shit. Felipe is in the house tonight. Whoa!
Felipe.
Go!
Esparza!
Esparza! Whoa!
Felipe.
Go!
What's up, boo? This episode is sponsored by DietSmoke.com. When CBD isn't enough, traditional THC is too much, enjoy the smooth buzz of Diet Smoke. Go to DietComb.com, use promo code FOOL, and get 20% off your order. That's FOOL. That's DietComb. DietSmoke.com, promo code FOOL for 20% off. What's up, food.com? What up, everybody?
What up?
We got Two Mix, man.
In the house.
Two Mix right here, you know. He's a favorite here at the Walk to the Food podcast. He was a guest in the past. And man, the holidays started early. Right now, I'm choking on that stuff that you put on Christmas tree to make them white.
Oh.
Frost.
That little frost.
Some snowflakes.
Yeah, man, that's snowflake.
You was huffing it or what?
I was standing too close, bro. Anyways, but we got Two Mix right here, and he has a brand new book that's out, and it's called Two Mix, Word Murder.
That's right.
It's right here, man. Where can they buy it? Before you start talking about it, where can they buy it at?
Oh, man, you can get it at twomexbook.com. Don't get easier than that. Just Two Mex, the number two, mexbook.com. It's a dope book, man, of my rhymes.
What is the book's about?
It's like it's about 70 of the lyrics to 70 songs, and then like another 30 poems, just random poems, man. I be all in my feelings on Instagram, writing like songs, like poems and stuff. And some cat from Texas, a fan named Parker Pubs, shout out Parker Pubs, he put it all together and was like, man, I want to make a book out of all your songs.
And the so lyrical assassin.
Made it happen, bro.
This is the kind of book, bro, when I was a junior in junior high, if I would have, like, know about Two Mix and no one else knew, I would have been saying his rhymes, bro, in front of everybody like I wrote them.
Yeah. Number one for super fan.
MC in the house.
Yeah.
Big fan.
Yo, we're going to take a throwback. Fuck your bottle of Ciroc. My life is a tobacco. Henry here and Lorraine Bracco, mayor of La Brea, king of King Taco. And I'm a ray of light. I read some David Icke, Stay in Light, and Until Me, and Iron Mike.
Are paid to like.
Fucking paid to like. I'm big fan of Van Vader. Like, I'm the dopest in the city to even wave a mic. I'm so large, I'll take the piece that Saber did at the Ali River, and I use it in a Saber fight. What's up, people?
That's what's up, man.
Is they know? Whap ass rhyme, man, like Chepo and shit outside the comedy club.
Oh, no. It's
practice good. In front of your friends, Ryan?
Straight fire, man. Straight fire.
Yeah, man. I'm hoping I'll be like, I know that some people, you know, the lyrics this and they could write. That was me, bro, when I was a kid. I thought I could write. But the performing part is the hardest part, man.
Yeah. But you was writing rhymes.
Sounding good. Sounding clear.
I was trying, bro. I used to listen to Uncle Jam's Army.
Hell yeah. That's the
you
real
up there
who
graduated in the late 80s.
Uh huh.
And KDY, switch reels. And so, yeah, man.
Taking you back to old school.
There's some people that could write, but they're afraid to step up to the mic. Do they write for people, or is that even considered a job?
Well, I ghostwrite for people. I used to ghostwrite for different people and stuff like that. Yeah. I mean, some people need help. Just like when they get more famous, they get more busy. So it's like, it's not
shit's
like
cracking.
It's like when, dude, if you all of a sudden, if you made some albums and now you're blowing up out of control and you got millions and then you're on your fourth, fifth album and sometimes you're just like,
writer's
you don't got
block,
that same,
yeah,
you don't
man.
Got that same, like, you're busy. So then, you know, people
we
like
a couple
me
of comedians that ghostwrite, man, and later on they're asleep, they hear hack.
Oh, like jokes? Oh, hack. Yeah.
I'm just that. Borrowing this one.
Yeah, I ghostwrite for various people, man. I put out a record called Ghostwriting Songs for God.
Damn.
That's all like ghost, you know.
Is that is biting a thing in hip hop?
To me,
that's people that happens a lot.
I come from a world. Oh man, it happens a lot, bro. All the biggest rappers. I'd say about 2 out of every 10 hits you can find where they stole it from. And I'm not trying to say
not only the lyrics but the music or vice versa.
The concept. Let me tell you, like not to go into Dr. Dre, right? The Chronic. There was a rapper in Inglewood. that first came out with the Chronic before Dr. Dre, because if you listen to N.W.A., what did Dr. Dre say on Express Yourself? I don't smoke weed or cess. Because there's nothing to give a brother brain damage. Brain damage. So you're talking about you don't smoke weed and then boom, you're the Chronic. So yeah, there's a, you know. Managed,
right?
There's a couple cats like Ice Cube and a couple famous biters that like famously just ripped off a gang.
I like real rapper, man. The one that rap about, you know, smoking Primos and then stealing their baby mama's diaper to buy more Primos.
There you go. That's what's that's see that's
keep a real
an average normal guy.
That's a
trap
real
it up.
Stuff. Man, there's a song by a rapper named Volume 10 about how his wife back when laptops, remember when laptops were really expensive?
Yeah,
His wife would go to work. He would take her laptop, go to the pawn shop, pawn it, take the money, buy some white girl, cut it, flip it, and by the time his wife got home, he'd have white girl for himself and then get the money to get his wife's laptop out the pawn.
That's genius,
that's
bro.
Gangster right
I
there.
I think we're with people that did the opposite of that.
what do you mean the opposite?
They would go pawn their keyboard right there on Eagle Rock, that pawn shop, and then use all that money to smoke crack.
Oh, yeah.
And well, then when they got their SSI or their GR check, they would grab that money and go back to that pawn shop and take that keyboard out.
Ah.
And write more music.
Well, back in the day when I was younger and super, super poor, we used to go to East Los and buy food stamps. Because, you know, you could buy, you know, when we could buy, like, me and my homie could put $100 on some food stamps and buy $400 of food stamps for $200. And then, you know, go back to the west side and use them up. So, you know, there's a million hustles. If you know
get invested over here.
Hustle,
crypto
bro.
And shit.
You got to know where to find them, bro.
Man, there's always a hustle, man. There's always like a hustle. Like, there's always a way, you know
like,
what I mean?
I don't know how people come up with these hustles. Like, when I graduated, well, I only graduated one time. I graduated sixth grade and then junior high. But I never graduated high school. But now if you go to any junior high school in East Los Angeles or Northern California, you know, Central California, South Central, especially Cudahy and Southgate. I think that's where it all started.
Cudahy.
Man, okay, your daughter graduated, Rodrigo, if you had a daughter, she's graduating class of 2022, you know, from junior high, class of 22 from high school. There are ladies outside selling Virgin Mary little things that says class of 2022. You gotta have it.
It's always a hustle.
I went to a graduation where they already had the pictures of the graduates out there selling them, dude. So, I mean, you know, it's a numbers game. So how much they're gonna hustle on me?
Yeah. I mean, it's just like selling. Remember, you go to a Dodger game?
Yeah.
And while you're waiting to go up the hills, fools are selling the bootleg Dodger hats.
Speaking of that, bro, Gabriel Iglesias is gonna be at Dodger Stadium.
What?
And that's, I mean, let me tell you, bro, when I found out that he's going to be at Dodger Stadium, because that's the biggest thing ever, right? Come on, as a comedian?
Yeah.
You can't top that, bro.
At Dodger Stadium?
So,
that's fresh.
Bro, just think about it, bro. The money that's going to be made just making bootleg shirts outside.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Make them a little Dodger bobblehead, huh?
And you don't have to pay Dodger Stadium for the logo. Dude, you don't got to pay nothing.
Hell nah.
Half of the Kobe shirts that I got, because I live in Mid-City, and I used to live by the Forum. Half of the Kobe shirts I would buy would be little bootleg iron on a Kobe for $5 with him holding a trophy. And I didn't care that they were bootleg. They were fresh.
But if I was
some of them are good, bro.
I would hire my own bootleg people, bro, to sell bootleg
see, that's next
some
level.
Of them are like indoor swap meet bootlegs, though, huh?
Bro,
iron on. Yeah, like
Martin Rizzo just came back from anime.
What's up, guys? Feliz
where
Navidad.
You at, bro?
Yu-Gi-Oh!
Dude, it was fucking insane.
Yo, hold your hands up. Oh my god.
He ran over here, dog.
Oh shit, I'm slipping.
Who's our
dude.
Guest tonight, bro?
Tumex, man.
Orale.
What's popping, bro?
Big fan, dude. Since
the lyrical assassin,
the visionaries.
Dog.
Bro, oh, you brought
up old school,
love.
Fool.
Oh, cool. Dude. Yeah, I'm trying to learn.
Hooked on phonics.
Continuation high school, dude.
Rosetta Stone.
Word, man. Much love on that, man. You guys show mad love.
So you've been doing a book tour?
No, the book just came. I've been like everybody else, just
pandemic hustle.
Yeah, pandemic, like just pandemic vacay. You know what I mean? I didn't play too many shows, and now we're trying to like maybe probably get out and do some stuff. I started a NFT crypto company with my homies.
What?
Called the Secret Saviors of Underground Hip Hop, and now we make digital NFTs for underground rappers.
That's
so
cool.
We put out, and then now we put music on them too. So we make exclusive songs that you could only get when you buy our packs of cards. So I kind of got into that because you know, I'm at home for like a year.
The future, dog.
NFTs, bro. Hey, I ain't even lying. That once we learned how to do what we needed to do, man, that company is blowing up. Secret Saviors of Underground Hip Hop. We're about to start series two.
Good for you guys.
What I gotta figure out what an NFT is, but we don't have time for that. Yeah.
I'm trying. It's a GIF? Is it a
non-fungible token?
Non-fungible
right?
token. Yeah. It's basically a piece of art that you can control the inventory of. Yeah. And when you control the inventory of it, only the person, like I'll give you an example. Felipe could do a 15-minute set that nobody's heard, and he could turn it into an NFT, and then he can control the inventory no matter what.
How do you make money, though?
Let me tell you. You never, ever, let me
educate
tell you.
Educate me, my G.
Never, ever. Let's say you made a 15-minute set, and you want to sell it as an NFT. Because of the blockchain technology, you could only the people that buy it off you can hear it. It could never be like put on YouTube as a bootleg, never be put on iTunes or nothing. So only the people that buy it can have it.
How much did they buy it for?
It's on you, bro. We were just talking about how Whitney Houston, they sold a demo of her when she was 17. It was just a demo song that nobody heard. They got a young girl to make the artwork, to make the painting. The song, they sold it for $1 million.
Shut the fuck
we
up.
Sell, let me tell you, we sell packs of cards, 6 cards come in a pack for $6, and we have cards that are worth $400.
Damn.
It's like baseball cards, but the thing is, the thing about digital art
comes with a digital signature, right?
Yeah, but the difference in the reason people are getting into digital art is because imagine all the things that you do have tangible, like posters or anything, pictures. What do? They fade. And so what's the point of investing a gang of money into art that's going to fade? Digital art it doesn't fade. So it's like, it's
gotta
a new way.
Gotta get a museum,
eh? It's kind of crazy. It's a crazy.
It is crazy.
Thing. It's a new hustle, bro, but it's we're with it, man. And then now we learn how to put music on the song. So let's say we have 5,000 packs that we're selling. We might have a card that there's 1,000 copies of, but the one with the song attached to it, there's only 50. So you're trying to buy the packs so you could get the song. The one with the song. You could have like 5. Remember we used to get baseball cards? And you'd be like, man, I've got 3. You're trying to get Fernando, right?
Yeah.
But you got a bunch of Frank Mickey Thomas. Hatcher, right? You got
Dale Clark.
Hey, you got 19 Mickey
Tom
Hatchers.
Two cents.
You got 19 Mickey Hatchers, but one Fernando. Yeah. So the thing is.
Mickey Hatcher.
You could get like 5 of 10 of the art cards that are the same, but you want the one with the song on it. And that one is worth more.
Basically, the golden ticket, huh?
That's the concept of digital art.
That shit looks skeptical to you, Felipe.
Yeah, I don't trust.
Hey, let me tell you.
I'm down to get into it.
Because wasn't like so. Does anything have to do with that one rich guy that owned that pharmaceutical company that had that rare Wu-Tang album?
Nobody knew it. Nobody knew it at the time, but that was actually the prelude.
First one?
That was really the first NFT because the concept of being like. There's only one album and only one person owns it, and he can't bootleg it. The blockchain technology doesn't let
you bootleg it. It's the same as trying to screenshot your bank account on your app.
What if Martin makes a porno?
It won't let you.
Huh?
Martin makes a porno with somebody and makes an NFT. Only some people can watch it.
Yeah, same thing. Man, right?
Right?
Hey, as long as the porno doesn't get a bad review.
This one got all vivid, huh?
But yeah, so that's what I'm doing, man.
To 50 cents.
So that's my thing, man. Secret Saviors of Underground Hip Hop, and now we're working on series 2. And so
sounds like a Ponzi scheme.
No, it's crazy. It's crazy.
I think it's almost like one of those things. It's only valuable to you, dog.
It's like digital. It's digital art.
It's
like
digital art.
People are. Oh, this is the thing. It's attached to crypto, right?
Yeah.
So let's say I'll give you an example. So let's say our company sells whatever, like come up with a 20 grand in stuff. If as the price of crypto rises, that 20 grand can rise to 90. And so you actually only really sell 20 grand of stuff, and it could rise to 90 because the price of crypto goes up. So that's why a lot of companies and people are investing in digital art because it appreciates up. Mm. It's crazy, bro. You know what? I got to teach
crazy.
You. I got an infomercial coming out. These brothers right here from Platform Collection, my brothers we've made an infomercial, so it's coming out soon. So I'm going to send it to everybody. It'll answer those questions because I spend a lot of time with people like, I don't get it. I watched the YouTube video. I still don't get it. We made a YouTube video that's going to explain everything. But it's crazy, bro. People are
making
bank.
So you're making money?
Bank, dude. It's doing good. It can do good.
Damn,
like really good.
Dude.
You do a 15-minute set that no one's ever heard here in your studio.
And your fans
And
do
you
it?
Put it out. You could say, I'm only going to sell 100 copies for $1,000 or whatever. And people will buy it. because they're going to be the only people that have it, and they can show it. Remember how a Richard Pryor record would be real secret, like you play it all secret to your friends because nobody... It's like you could make an NFT and be like, there's only 100 copies in the world, and I'm going to sell them for a gang of price. And
what if nobody wants to buy it, though?
People, you think nobody...
You're not losing money from me, you know?
Let me give you an example, bro. Let me give you an example.
1,000 DVDs.
I'll give you an example,
I think there's going to be a lot of those people.
I took one of my album. I took one of my albums called Lospital, and I put it as a $1 NFT, okay? I sold like 700. Somebody, in the next day, he bought it for a dollar. He resold it for $588, and somebody bought it. So there's always somebody that wants it, bro. It's like, trust me. People that love you, imagine having a Felipe comedy thing that no one in the world has but them to show to their friends. Yeah, and nobody has it but them. Nobody has it. It will never be out. Only the 10 copies.
It'll be tough for a stand-up comedian because comedians, they love saying the same shit over and over again. They like the feedback on a good-ass joke.
I was just using you as an example of like what you could do with a 15-minute set.
But my painting, my art.
Yeah.
I'm
just kidding. I'm
saying, good, bro.
But you know what, bro? We could do a podcast. You say we ever have a guest that's badass. Everybody wants to see him. We can have the
something like
you could take an hour and a half podcast.
People are doing podcasts as NFTs too. You know what I mean? But they sell them for cheap. So if you do a podcast that no one's heard, you could sell it for a buck. And hey, you sell a couple thousand.
So it's like the unreleased tapes or something like that, you know?
The B sides,
basically. Yeah.
We should charge. Yeah. There should be a way that you could make money while people are chatting during a podcast, bro. Mm. So like 10 cents a chat. So say you want to say, oh, they fucking hate this podcast. Take them 10 cents.
Well, the secret of it is the secret
got
is
a million
the rarity.
Of those, huh?
The secret of it is the rarity. Because people don't understand, they think you could bootleg it. Like,
Right.
Like my shit are cards, right? So anybody's like, man, I could screenshot it and I have it now. So, you know? And I'm like, no, it's not about that. It's about having the real authentic thing. That's the difference.
It's going to go into your NFT wallet, right? Your collection.
Yeah, I have a digital wallet, yeah.
I remember the comedian, man. He made these cards for comedians.
Uh-huh.
But they were like baseball cards, just cardboard cards.
They're physical stats.
Not worth anything.
But because, stats, you know why? Here. Why though? Because
three stolen jokes.
Because they're physical and they eventually...
They deteriorate.
Yeah. Digital art is not going to. So
be like
the
Da Vinci Code, dude. Put that shit behind glass and gas.
Speaking of stuff that ain't worth much, man, I'm still not listening right to the podcast. So I went to one of those hobby places today by accident.
Uh-huh.
It's right next to a porn shop.
Damn.
But I went in there because some dude, you going in there? And I said, all right, I'll go in there. Bro, and there was like three dudes in there, bro. Those two, three guys were wearing hoodies. They smelled like couches.
Oh, dude, still about moms, huh?
They had all the toys, bro.
Damn.
I was trying to find a Spider-Man for my grandson, but all the Spider-Mans they had were the $75 expensive one that he's going to break in 2 days.
Oh, collectors, collector pieces.
I'm a big toy collector.
So you have the book out again, bro. Where can they find you on Instagram?
2MEX, OMD, the number 2, MEX, OMD. OMD stands for Mexican descent. That's my first band. That's my first band ever. 2MEX, OMD, and the book's called Word Murder. And 2mexbook.com, it's just came out, so it's doing good.
You're gonna perform tonight, right?
Man, I'm gonna kill it for you.
Spit some bars.
I came dressed like a can of almond roca for you, bro.
Okay. What's up?
Looking nice.
Ooh, man. What's up, everybody, man? You know,
I don't wear pink. This is it for you, bro. I got
the Energizer rabbit with no energy. What's up, fool? You know, man. My problem with edibles. You know my problem with edibles. You probably too, bro.
Is what's that?
I get too high sometimes, bro, and I can't drive my helicopter around town.
It's over.
You know, it can be really difficult to control the dose, you know, because you don't know the level. Sometimes, you know, man, you take one, then you're at the DMV and you got to take the test, you know, and you can't think straight. You're paranoid, man. You take the bus home because you're scared. That's why when I need a perfect medium high, bro, I hit up my friends.
A diet smoke.
Yeah.
And these things, man, they're crazy.
You just got the 10 milligram dosage. You're never going to get too
high.
You
take one, but you don't feel like you're under the bus, man. You feel like you're on top of the bus and you're controlling the bus.
A mellow high.
You feel good.
It don't make you all sluggish, wango. Huh? Can I take one?
Go for it, bro.
Go for it, man.
I'm down, bro.
That's why when I need the perfect medium high, I hit him up, bro. You know, what's up, Diet Smoke?
Thank you, Diet Smoke.
For the
Smoke.
Delicious Delta 8 THC gummies.
They taste good. They don't taste all chemically.
Yeah. Less sugary, too. What is Delta 8?
I'll tell you right now, big dog. Delta 8 is a simply slightly less potent THC, the THC that you're probably most familiar with, Delta 9, bro. Don't confuse it with the Delta 9 variant, okay? Both are natural to the cannabis plant. Diet smoke extracts the Delta 8 from hemp, bro. Now, you're probably asking yourself, does diet smoke really get you high? Of course! The high you get with diet smoke is the best described as somewhere between chillness of CBD and that classic stone feeling you get with regular weed. Oh, so, you know, for your migraines, bro, your anxiety would be perfect, but don't take too much.
No, yeah, because then I'll
go... No more anxiety.
Because then you fall off the skateboard, bro. You can't hang out with George Wang no more.
But that sounds good, man.
I'm with it, bro.
Try it right now, bro. See what happens.
There you go, my dude.
Diet smoke isn't like one in. It's just right. It's like hitting a bowl, bro, of some stuff that you paid too much backstage from somebody. But it's all right. You're like, you know what? Just miss home now. Plus, diet smoke and two delicious flavors, blue raspberry and watermelon. I've had the watermelon. It was delicious. So, when CBD isn't enough and traditional THC is too much, enjoy the smooth buzz of diet smoke. Go to dietsmoke.com and use the promo code FOOL, F-O-O-L, for 20% off your order. That's FOOL, F-O-O-L. Diet Smoke, promo code FOOL for 20% off. Diet Smoke, Delta 8 THC gummies are not for for use or sale to people under the age of 21. What's up, fool? Get them right now. It's the last stuff you can't do between the age of 21, but posing nude is all right. What's up, everybody?
Yeah, I'm with it, man. Come to the studio. It, I'll be outside selling them bootleg.
Yeah, NFTs, baby.
NFTs, eh?
So what's up, everybody?
What up, dog?
Hell yeah, man. What's next, then, man?
Christmas.
I'm excited, dude.
Fuck yeah, dude. Can't wait to open presents tomorrow.
We got Willie Barcena waiting over there, bro. Dodger hat looking like Tommy Lasorda.
In the dugout, dog.
Willie.
He's in the dugout ready, dog.
Put me in, coach.
Oh, we got two mechs. Thank you, two mechs, man.
Thank you very much, big dog. Yeah, keep shining, bro. You're going to
perform later, man, so don't get scared.
I'm with it, bro. I'm going to be here.
Yeah, man. So you go ahead.
Let's cut out right here.
We got the homie here with a badass shirt of the Beatles, but they're stormtroopers.
Oh, yeah, two mechs, man. That's what all the skaters listen to in high school, man.
Oh, man.
Two mechs.
Yeah, the SGV, dude.
That means a lot, bro.
Hell yeah.
Oh, San Gabriel Valley? Oh, that was mine.
I remember one time, man, somebody told it to Paul Rodriguez. I used to watch you when you were little. And that guy had like a beard, like a white beard. And Paul Rodriguez said, "What the fuck am I, a caveman?"
How old are you, bro? You're older than me, dog.
You're fuck, hey.
You're my grandpa.
You're my grandpa. You know, you never lit away.
He was born old.
Paul Rodriguez started banging on that foot for like 10 minutes straight, dog.
Dude, you can't be all messed up talking about it. I saw you when you were little.
Look like Lauren Green, bro, from Bonanza.
Hey, fool, how about that dude in San Antonio? You're all, hey, man, happy birthday. You're 40. You're 50 years old. I'm 48.
I'm 46.
I was like, damn.
He's here, bro. What's up, man?
You know what, Rasa? I'm on the naughty list, eh?
I'm on the naughty list, eh? Santa, eh?
You've been Santa chingazos.
And me too, bro. What the heck? We're on the same list.
You got right there, bro. Your wingman.
I'm going to pull a sled after this. Huh? So Willie's here, man. Willie's on?
What up, dude?
What do we got, bro? What's up, fool?
Woo!
What's up, big dog?
Orale. What's up,
man? Oh, hell yeah.
Can we hear you?
You got to put on your headphones.
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah. No, I can hear you guys, man.
What's up, man?
Hey, bro.
Go ahead.
Hey, I love Martin, man. You know, at his house, at his mom's house, she's missing curtains, bro.
Wait, huh? It's all about individuality.
Hey, bro, these are sarape pants, and my legs are warm, bro. I don't know. Over there in Vegas, it's hot, but here it's cold, homie. That's in Southern California.
Bro. I think you took your tia's blanket, bro. I
did. He took the cobija out of Chete's casket.
Hey, bro, those pants came with trophies on top.
Por mis malditos pantalones, dog.
You know, I lie, bro. I seen these pants, those same exact pants that this other company appropriated. It's called Avia Sweats.
Uh-huh.
And they were $500.
Damn, suck really? My
are those the same ones?
No way, bro.
These are Gucci. These are sarape,
bro. When I saw them coming, I said, oh, yeah.
So you got a tailor?
I got.
But was it the same materials that Rayo Sarape's, bro?
It looks exactly like those, but there's this, It's a surfer wearing them all with the tight stuff.
$500.
$500. Okay. Philip, look it up.
Five handy, bro.
And I just want to say thank you for me coming in and you guys making me feel welcome by just talking shit within the first 30 seconds.
Hey, Willie,
it's fantastic. I feel like it's 20 years ago and it's all happening all over again.
I'm in the parking lot. I'm about to bark at the moon.
Do those pants light up and shit or what?
Those are tight, bro.
I like them, man.
Thank you.
But you wear those not just for Christmas, you wear them all the time.
I wear them all the time. Yeah.
You're a badass, dude. Man.
Thank you.
Dude, if you could find a fucking, like, a suit, like, for the fucking, the top part, that'd be badass.
We're working
dude.
On it.
But you can't be, like, 5'2" wearing those, bro. You're going to be nada, bro.
You're like a little cape, huh?
Willie, would you wear those? Nah, bro. Oh, bro.
You know what, bro? I would wear them, but at home. Not in public, bro, but yeah, I would, go to bed.
Like pajamas. Nah, dude, I'm just comfortable, homie, and I'm warm. And, man,
he's an eccentric, that, homie.
Willie's performing in Las Vegas. Where are you performing at, bro?
Well, I'm at the Strat here, bro. I'm actually in my room. I have the show in a couple hours, but I'm at the Strat. Bro, Christmas in Vegas is the best. You know why? Because everybody has like a very cheery feeling, you know. Even the hookers are nice, man.
I thought you were gonna say because you're there and your family's not there.
No, anybody that comes to Vegas doesn't want to be with their family. You know, that's why Vegas is cool during Christmas. If you don't like your family, if you have like a brother or sister that annoys you and you hate going to those parties, you know, like you have to go to the get together and the truth doesn't come out till you get a little buzz and you're like, you know what? I fucking never liked you, man.
I know, bro. You start getting anxiety,
right here,
bro.
Right here, everything's cool for Christmas, you know. Everybody gets along. Everybody hates their relatives.
You start feeling a little anxiety, bro. Like when you're going to a relative you don't like, you start seeing the exits, you start counting, oh man, two more. What am I going to say?
How long is it going to last? Close.
You know, there's a lot of pressure in the holidays to just be on your best behavior every fucking reunion that you go to, you know? And I think it's sad when you can't be who you are around your family. You go with your family and you got to pretend you don't drink. You got to pretend you don't smoke weed. Huh. You got to pretend you don't do this.
What's up with those pants?
You know, fuck it. And here's the thing. Like, at some point, you just got to look at your family and say, hey, cabrones, this is me. If you don't like it, then fucking don't invite me no more. Eh?
Yeah. I remember one time, you ever bring a different girlfriend to your mom's house? Never met.
Like, Santa the player.
They're just staring at her, man, but they can't say nothing because it's Christmas. They can't call your wife.
hey, let me guess.
I did that one time, man. My dad, everybody, nobody said nothing, bro. We just ate tamales.
Did you introduce her?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
She was part of the family. Nah.
La otra.
It was crazy, dog.
Yeah. Hey, Felipe, you know my mom was ruthless, bro. I remember one time I brought a chick home. Before I got married, bro, right? Before those days. But I brought a chick home, and literally, bro, my mom says it out loud. Oh, ¿ya te gustan las feas? I'm like,
damn, that wasn't a good year, mom.
No, I got babies.
She was all like, fucking head count. What the fuck?
She was putting gas in the Volkswagen.
She was ruthless.
Don't be bringing no monsters over here to the patty.
Fuck.
It's not Halloween, man.
Bitches chupacabras,
YouTube,
dude.
Bro, or what?
No, man. The weird thing is, like, so my ex-girlfriend, I brought her to Thanksgiving, and then we broke up, and then so, like, Christmas time was coming, so I didn't have her, so, like, that was fucking awkward.
Damn.
Bro, I showed up.
You still miss her, huh, dog?
A few Christmases ago, I showed up to my sister's and my mom's pad with a new girlfriend, a new kid, a homegirl who had her kid, and they didn't have nowhere to go. And then I got high, and we went to Knott's Berry Farm for mimosas and shit. And then we showed up to the holiday party at the fan. They were just looking at me like, it looked like I had a harem of new wives and shit. And they didn't know. They didn't ask. They just said, No. They weren't. They were not my girlfriend.
I know, man.
No, it was fun. And actually, we went. No. It wasn't Christmas. It was Thanksgiving. And we went to go feed the homeless before that over in.
This fool was already touring back then. Eh?
Yeah, dude.
But they didn't, in their defense, they didn't say shit. They just
this already
up.
Had a following, eh?
And like you said, it's the holiday, so they just gotta smile and be nice and shit. Unless you're Willie's mom that just says, "Hey, está fea la cabrona."
No, hey, I gotta tell you something though, Martin. What trips me out is like you're like all rugged looking, you know. You look like a biker type, and then you go. I have mimosas.
With that pinky up, dog.
He didn't always look like that. Beard, he wear biker shorts.
The most interesting guy in the world. Eh?
What did you say, Willie?
No, bro. I was gonna hear a beer or vodka, something.
I drank gasoline,
bro. I remember one time we went to Willie's house and we had people over, and when he was single and he was trying to like impress, you know. I thought he was gonna bust out just a bag of hot Cheetos, you know, or potato chips, and put salsa in it. But now, man, if we started opening up Lunchables, it made like a whole little plate, like Lunchable meats, little cheeses. I said, "What the fuck?"
Like a fucking charcuterie,
charcuterie board, eating
doors, right?
Out of fucking Lunchables,
lunch cooteries.
Hey, bro, I need them look fancy though, brother.
Hey, I'm gonna rate that shit. I'm like, all right, eh.
Those shit's no, at the spot,
hey, I don't
bro.
Know what is that. There's something in me that when people come over, man, I gotta feed them. You know, I don't know why I do that, and I guess because when I was little, I used to go to my relative's house. Hey, Felipe, did your mom or dad ever do that? You go to like an uncle's house and they tell you, hey, don't ask for food, right?
Y'all
I don't
time, want them to think
that you ain't hungry, dog.
My mom would right? pinch my mom would pinch my thigh, like no.
Yeah.
No,
so I hated that, man. So when people come over, I just feed them, man. I mean, Martin, you were at my house a few months ago, bro, and I had a big spread, bro. I had the spaghetti, the pizza, the lasagna.
Casarich.
All kinds of. You don't know you
did. Hey,
no, let me tell you something. I think it's.
Carne asada.
I think a lot of times too, it's cultural. You know, there's some people that'll be like, oh no, le des ni madre. But then there's people that just overextend themselves. Like you showed up at my pad. There was coffee. There was beer. There was. Food, whatever the hell you wanted, it was always there.
A machine gun, eh?
Nah, my jefa was always really, really, really a giver when it came to food, coffee, and shit like that.
But also, like, dude, the culturally, like, food-wise, it's always, you know, matter whatever you fucking have. And you can revive food, old tortillas and old-ass meat, dog.
I've been to houses, bro, where they didn't have shit, eh?
Horrible, dog.
And, like, I went to...
should be shot.
Play Madden at somebody's house, but his name started with an insect name. And I was there with another comedian who passed away. And that fool ate all the candies, right? All the candies, all the Snickers, everything, right? Without asking, he ate everything. And then when he left, that fool said, "Oh man, I can't believe that fool ate all my dinner just like that."
Yeah. And it was, hey, bro, you know the way, Felipe. Felipe, the worst thing is when someone comes over your house, you invite them, and they bring nothing with them, bro. This one ghetto dude, bro, I invited him to my house. He brought a tall can just for himself.
I'm only going to stay for a half hour. Eh?
Hey, fool. Hey, Willie, you know who I ran into? And he told me to tell you what's up, but I don't even know what city I ran into you. He remembers you, too. It was that biker dude that used to hang around with us from Temple Street named Angel.
Yeah, he's in San Antonio now.
Yeah, he's still wearing the biker chain.
You can't take it off.
That fool was sober, bro. That fool, like, he would watch our back, bro. He'd be just hanging out, bro. Like, he had to go to work in the morning, dog. I think he was a truck driver.
He was like open mic and hanging out. Bodyguard.
Yeah, remember him? Angel, right?
Yeah, Angel.
That's fucking funny. You knew exactly who he was talking about before he even said the name.
On Temple Street.
Yeah.
The Angel of Death.
Oh,
hey, back in the day at that club, bro, we all needed some backup, man. I mean, some of the, you know, because those cholos would get drunk, bro, and right away they're like, hey, that's not funny, puto.
I remember the first time I went to Monterey, California. I'd never been there before. I went with Willie and his friend Gus and Sal. And, you know, the show, I don't know what time the show starts, but we left at 4, dog.
In the afternoon.
4 in the afternoon.
L.A.?
Yeah, and this fool drove, bro. No pee, no nothing, dog. All the way to Monterey. His homie wanted to pee. Nah, bro, we're going to be late, eh?
That was the back drawing, dog.
Hey, you know that exit to Monterey? Where you pass that, you're going to make that ride by Denny's and Salinas?
Salinas.
I'll put over that fucking Denny. Nah, we're going to be late, eh? And then we got there, bro. It was time for him to go up. No way. I washed his face in the bathroom, bro. He killed him for about an hour, bro. But fuck, yeah, bro. Hey, we're talking about...
Remember the two Italians, the owners, bro?
Hell yeah, bro.
Frankie and Anthony?
Planet Gemini?
So Willie was there, bro, on the second night, and there was a lot of Crips, bro, from Seaside. A shitload. And so I thought that Willie was already loud with them. Oh, shit, they're going to kill us. But Willie was buying them rounds of tequila shot when he was on stage. And then later on, bro, the Northern Gang showed up, you know, from to watch the show.
Man, I can't believe you remember this
and
shit,
they were,
bro.
I was sober, dog. And then they were heckling Willie. And then Willie said some shit about their mom. All the fools stood up. Bro, it was going to be a Crip gang against those fools, bro, because... He goes, nah, man, you ain't fucking with a headliner and shit, cuz. And bro, it was crazy, dog.
The Crips backed him up?
Willie, yeah.
Damn, dude.
Hey, Felipe, I never told you this, Crip, bro. Walking. I never told anybody this. It's one of those things you keep to yourself. You're like, fuck it, no one will ever know. I don't give a shit. Well, I was in the restroom because I'm not my pelo, bro. So after the show, I was a little buzzed, and I was singing in Spanish, right? I was singing like a Chente song, you know, volver, volver, you know. And all of a sudden, bro, I hear one guy close the restroom. He closes the restroom, and I look behind, and there's like five brothers, bro, five black guys going, what's with all that Spanish, motherfucker, right? And I was like, oh, man, you know, I like to sing Spanish once in a while, man, you know? Bro, and they were like, man, you should just hit this motherfucker. Like, there was a big one that said, we should just hit this motherfucker right now. And the little one, there was a little Eazy-E-looking fucker. He was the boss. And he like, no, man. And I was like, hey, man, come on. I was the comedian, man. I was telling those jokes about growing up poor. And then they were switching everything around. They were like, what you trying to say, motherfucker? We poor too? Is that what you trying to say? No,
man. Well, I'm over here with a bunch of executives, eh?
Yeah, bro. Hey, the little dude is the one that said, you know what, man? Fuck this motherfucker. Look at him crying and shit. Let him go.
Shut up. Damn. Little dudes always have that heart, huh? Let him go.
Yeah. Yeah, bro, I went outside. I was shaking, bro. There was a little bench right outside the restaurant. I was just like, all right, I survived that one.
Where was Gus, dog?
Damn, you know, it's crazy to, like, when you think about all the places that you've been through all the years, the hole in the walls, the crazy. When you're talking about Crips and Northerners in the same place, that's a recipe for fucking, like, murder, bro.
Disaster,
you know
bro.
What I mean? Like, the fact that we're still here talking about that shit.
So the next day, we were eating, and I always talk about this when I do a radio station, because Willie was there, and I made the whole breakfast morning uncomfortable, bro. Because we met Reggie Jackson.
Oh! Bro!
That fool used to hang out at Bentley's in Long Beach, fool.
Yeah, he went to Seaside, bro. We were having a delicious breakfast. A scrumptious breakfast.
Bro.
I don't know what to say.
Can I tell him what you did?
Tell him, bro.
All right. So, hey, check this out, guys. We're having breakfast at this nice place in Monterey, and Reggie Jackson owns dealerships over there. That's why he's in Monterey. So we're having breakfast, and then Felipe goes, hey, that's Reggie Jackson right there. And I look up, and I go, oh, shit, Reggie Jackson, man. Man, I'm like a little starstruck. You know, I don't get starstruck too much, but when it comes to, like, you know, baseball players from the past, man, I'm like, you know, I'm like a little chick, you know. And so, so we're done eating, and then – and Felipe gets up. I get up. Felipe pats Reggie Jackson in the back, bro. This is exactly what happened. I'm not exaggerating anything. I'm not trying to, you know, this is exactly how it happened. He pats Reggie Jackson in the back. Reggie Jackson is holding his fork, and he looks back at Felipe, and Felipe goes, hey, I remember when Bob Welch struck you out in the World Series.
Oh, my God.
It's like, fucking asshole. I had to stay there and, like, look at him because I froze.
When he tells him, like, bro, you came back and hit 3 home runs. He goes, I know what you did. Yeah, I know what that. I did. Go tell your friend that.
Yeah, I did tell him that. I go, hey, but, you know, you hit it out the park next time you saw him. He goes, yeah, go tell your friend. I don't know, bro. I couldn't. I could not believe that's what you were going to say.
Well,
I cannot believe.
Hilarious,
dog. Hey, how you doing, Mr. November?
We were in San Francisco, and Dave Winfield was out front in front of that hotel.
Hell yeah, bro. He was standing there with his coat and his hat.
Yeah. That was freaking, and you're like, that's because you recognize fools all over the fucking place, bro. Like, they're just sitting there completely under a bush with a hat on, and you still know who those motherfuckers are.
Radar detector.
We're at that Denny's, bro, and Fletcher. Willie told me, oh, bro, Paul Rodriguez over there. Go say what's up. And I went over there and said, what's up? And I sat down. It was a Paul Rodriguez.
Who was it, dog? It looked like?
From Cachetón, bro. Looked just like him, bro.
Hey, bro, I used to do that to a lot of people, bro. I would go, hey, bro, guess who's over there, dog? And it just had to look like that person. And then, you know, you go over there and they're like, ah, oh, you're a dick, dude. Oh, I thought that's who it was, bro.
Were you performing that this weekend?
At the Strat, bro, right here in Vegas, man.
The Stratosphere?
The badass Strat with I don't know, man. They have the way they do it, they have a headliner, and then they have, like, 8 guest spots, you know?
Damn. So,
No, they don't have 8. I'm exaggerating.
Long-ass show.
I don't want the owner to see this and go, man, this is ungrateful motherfucker.
Hey, you were doing late shows over there, right?
I did. It was during COVID, bro.
Yeah.
Because nobody else was opening. So these guys took a chance, you know, Vegas and Arizona, I think, and Texas were the only ones that were taking chances, man. So to keep from going crazy, I just came up with ideas, you know. I called them up and I go, hey, I know Vegas, you guys are starting to open, man. I got, you know, let's do a midnight show. And they go, we've never done a midnight show. Bro, doing a midnight show in Vegas is a little exhausting, bro, because you literally don't feel like a comedian. You feel like a lion tamer. Like, oh, yeah. Everybody's fucked up, and you gotta. It's almost like you turn into that guy. Listen. You know?
I hate that.
It's like fucking.
I don't know, man. They heckle at another level when they're fucked up, bro.
I did like 2 midnight shows at the Billiards Bar place on Fremont, the 3BBs.
Mm-hmm.
It was a midnight show right after the Canelo fight. So we're gonna have a comedy show after the fight. They was packed.
People are fucked up already,
bro,
huh?
They were fucked up.
Wanting to fight.
Yeah, that's fucking combat.
Was fucked up. We'll get beat up by a lady too. And those people were loaded, huh?
Yeah, dude.
Luckily, there was a guy that was so loaded. He recognized Frank Correa, the comedian, right, mm-hmm. from a podcast, and he fucking Frank Correa just gave him a ride home, bro.
Damn, dude.
Hey, bro, those edibles that you guys are taking, man. Man, I will never take those again. I'm sure those are good. I'll try those because you gave it that. You said that these are different, but I've tried other edibles.
Oh, he's on an edible right now, bro.
He's on edible mode.
He froze.
Am I still?
No, you're good.
You're good.
And they fucked you up?
Okay, so no, check this out. So I'm on stage, bro. I don't know if I told you this, man. You know, I got so fucked up, bro. I was trying to sober up. I called my friend. I couldn't even explain words. My friend's like, wow. I was like, hey, bro, bring me that round thing. He's like, what round thing? It's a round thing, man. It's bread. And what, a donut? No, it's round with meat inside, man. He goes, oh, hamburger? Yeah, bring me that.
God damn.
That's how fucked up I was, bro.
How many did you take?
Go, okay. I said, bro, because I took about two. I took 2 bags, bro. My dumb ass.
Damn.
I get overdose. To the show and I go, okay, I don't want the owner to see that I'm doing this. I'm gonna try to act normal. You know, you try to act normal, and the more normal you try to act, the more fucked up you look.
Yeah.
So I said, no, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna be professional. I go on stage, I kill it, bro, kill it. And the owner, I look at him with a big smile. I go, what'd you think of that? And he goes, no, it's great, bro, but you only did 10 minutes. I was supposed to do an hour. But yeah, man. Anyways, yeah, bro.
Give me another bag.
You remind me of the edibles when I saw your edibles there.
I just tried them. They're good. Delta. What is it?
Diet Smoke.
Diet Smoke. Delta 8 gummies. Blue raspberry.
It takes like 2 hours to hit. Like the first hour, you're right. But then by the second hour, you're feeling like stoned. But then it goes away like in 40 minutes.
That's good. Damn. So it's like it's one of those things where you gotta be careful because like if you're like it hasn't hit me yet, and then you fucking take another one.
But you're one of those people that like to be really high. You're not used to this. You're going to take too much, and then you're going to be out of commission, bro.
I got fucked up on those edibles from last time, those chocolate malts. I seriously was thinking I made up my whole life in my head. I was like, dude. Like, and I was talking to Gabby, and she said the same thing. She thought she made up the pandemic in her head. And she was asking people, wait, we're in a pandemic, right? It's just one of those things, man. You get paranoid, you know?
Hey, what? How are people? I know people, like, are dealing with a pandemic. Like, you took a booster shot?
Not yet.
You?
Not yet.
No, me neither, bro.
But you have to be like 65 to get it?
No.
I took the sarampión, bro.
Older people first, eh?
Man, it's on pot chatting already.
Not the booster.
Okay. We had a battle put to perform, but that fool got COVID, dog.
Dude, people are getting COVID like crazy.
Yeah, but
everybody in the mother has COVID.
How much
you put
of people like who get COVID, yeah. Like you just said that the NBA, like, where are these dirty ass strip bars they're going to, bro?
Vegas, eh?
Willie's still alive. Joe Diaz is alive. Oh, bro. People that we
have a spot
out with,
right now, bro.
Rodrigo hangs out with some guy every Wednesday night, and they tell me that Nicolas has not changed, bro, that it got him better.
It's popping right now, they say.
Really?
Hey, Felipe, do you remember one time, bro, we did a show at the Laugh Factory in Hollywood?
Yeah.
And you brought a guest. And you mentioned him from stage. You mentioned Father Greg Boyle, remember?
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember this. And then I went on after you, and I introduced my guest, and it was the owner of Nicolas, the strip club. Remember that, bro?
Yeah, bro.
So Nicolas is still open?
Yeah, bro. It's happening, man. People go there, show me videos.
Dude, when they opened up, because they were closed down for the longest, and then when they opened up, I remember like fucking just... I would do Lyft, and I'd fucking take people there, pick up people. I was just busy in that whole area, bro. It was crazy.
I saw a video of one of the guys that we know, and he had the girl wearing a mask and giving a full-on lap dance.
Bro, look, you were just talking about everybody, like, oh, so-and-so, they had to cancel because they had COVID. The booster, la chingada. You got people showing up to events with thousands of people.
Yeah.
Nobody gives a fuck.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody, Disneyland's over fucking it, bro. Open. There's no masks. Everybody's in the goddamn line for Snow White. No mask, right?
Not even Mickey Mouse walking
around
with no mask.
But then there's families having meetings wondering if they should get together for the holidays. It's like
they never see each other.
Those are some fucking extremes right there, bro.
That's gonna be your last Christmas plan.
That's a crazy extreme. There's nothing that's like so far apart.
bro, you wanna hear an extreme? And this is the truth. I'll take a picture of it, man, and send it to you guys. The hookers are wearing masks, bro. That's the truth.
Damn.
They don't kiss anyways, right?
They're not supposed to.
They give you like a little kiss, like
a little peck on the cheek.
The hookers are wearing. You know, Nicolas, Saint Nick is the patron saint of hookers. Did you know that?
He's know the craziest shit about religion, my thing. Sometimes I think he's shit up.
Raza.
I'm going to look it up now.
Bro, talk about religion with Martin, and he'll bring out the most obscure shit. Jesus and the Ten Commandments. And he goes,
that's where Santa Claus. What?
There's seven drawers, eh?
No, it was a Greek dude,
Here we go.
He broke a plate.
It was really wealthy dude, and there was this really poor family.
With two hot chicks, right?
There was a poor family with the dude had two daughters. Yes,
yeah, and they were in debt. They were in heavy debt.
In one of the earliest attested and most famous incidents from his life, he is said to have rescued three girls from being forced into prostitution.
Yeah. So he's considered the patron saint of prostitutes. So he wanted to help this. So back in the day, you couldn't marry your daughters. So he was broke, right? And he couldn't pay the dowry so that people could marry the daughter. Back in the day, like you used to have to pay so somebody could take care of your, it's like, hey, or take her here, take a couple of goats and take my wife or my daughter, right?
Yeah. Take
and
my daughter, please.
And so, this dude couldn't afford the money, so his daughters are going to be, you know, cursed into a life of prostitution. This guy wanted to help him, so he threw a sack of money through the window. Mm-hmm. And the dude got the money, and then he was able to take one daughter. All right, you can go get married. The next one threw sack through the window, married the other daughter. On the third one, the dude said, fuck it, hey, I'm going to stay up and see who's doing this shit. Homeboy found out the plan, and he said, all right, I'm going to switch it up on him. And that day, he decided to throw the sack through the chimney. Oh, wow. And one of the daughters had hung up her stockings. She washed them, and she hung them up by the goddamn fucking chimney to dry. And then the sack landed in the stocking, and it's a Christmas miracle, motherfuckers.
Yeah, bro.
I was there, eh? Santa Cholo was born.
I read get that this year also, man. That's a fact.
Santa's saving the ho-ho-hos, man.
So that's when you said Nicolas. I'm like, hey, this is all full circle. It's Christmas time. And if you want to celebrate Christmas like the real traditional
giving,
the Christian way, go rescue some hookers.
He's like stopping the human trafficking. He was ahead of his time.
That's why Willie's in Vegas. You
know, save those hoes, fool.
Yeah.
Okay, now I get the ho-ho-ho things.
We need three of them. Hey,
you know, Martin, you remind me of the mailman from Cheers, bro. You always have, it's a little known fact.
Some obscure little piece of history. Tidbit, a little nook. Yeah, yeah. A little trinket.
Joe Diaz told me to tell you, what's up, cocksuckers? I talked to him today. Because I was reading this book about the corporation. It's about the true life story of the Cuban mafia in the United States. And when I told Joe Diaz that, bro, I'm in the credits. I helped the guy write the book.
Yeah, Joey knows some people, bro. You know,
sometimes when you talk to Joey,
when you talk to Joey, you're almost like, hey, bro, I don't think I should know this.
You become an accessory when you listen to one of those stories, huh? Remember, you took the fucking money. What? And you grab the machine gun. It's your fingerprints. Touch this glass.
God damn.
I love Joey, bro. Joey was the only comedian, guys, and I apologize to him since, but he was the only comedian I've ever told not to be dirty, you know? And I swear to God, bro, 5 years later, I saw him at the club, and I go, bro, do you remember when we were in Texas and I told you not to be dirty? And Joey being Joey, you know, he's like, yeah, I remember. I said, I'm sorry, bro. I was a fucking idiot. I mean, who tells Joey not to be dirty, right? Who's got the fucking balls to be
you,
an asshole?
Multiple times, because he told him in Oxnard, too, eh?
I remember Willie, when he first, like, I think, I don't know if that was the first time he met him, but he worked with Joe Diaz and Mark Babbitt out of town in Texas. And he goes, so you worked with Joe Diaz? Oh, yeah, I met that guy, yeah. He was all over the promoters calling him a legend and... You're a beast and you're a maniac.
Damn.
Because that's the way Joe Diaz talks. You know, he was telling Mark Babbitt, you're a legend.
You're a legend. You're a maniac. There was a show that I did with you, Willie, in Oxnard, and I had just started doing comedy. And I was at the Performing Arts Center, and Joey was supposed to be there. But he was running way late. He was stuck in traffic with Noe Gonzalez. And so they had to, like, we stalled the show like half hour. Fuck. And then you told me, go up there. And I was going to do a guest spot, but then they kept telling me to fucking stretch. Had nothing to fucking stretch, bro.
Show them the pants.
I was up there. I might as well have been twisting fucking balloons, bro. I had nothing left to say. I ran out of like, so what do you do? Like, I was like, I like just looking over like, somebody help me. And they just keep going like this, bro. And I'm like, fuck. And then finally they showed up. And, dude, these guys had been partying. They had been partying hard. You could tell the sweat was coming down. And then Willie said, hey, whatever you do, go up there and be clean, bro. And so he goes up there.
You're a maniac.
The first thing he does is pull down his fucking pants. See? That's what Joey opened with. He pulled down. And then Willie's like, fuck. I told him, you're already hot, bro, because everybody was late and all this shit. And you're like, hey, half that money should go to you because you had done all the set and they're trying to fuck with the money. Bro, that's just when Joey looked at the two promoters and he goes, you better not fuck with me. I'll shove you up your brother's ass and put you out his mouth.
Yeah, that's when Joey used to want his money. Remember, Joey?
He wanted cash, cocksucker.
You know?
Yeah.
I mean,
there's a reason why he wanted cash back there, right, Felipe?
Child support,
But this was 20 years ago, right? It's like,
I know, it's 20 years ago, but I'm saying this is back in the day.
Yeah.
Obviously, this is like decades ago, you know? We're not ratting anybody out.
Yeah,
this
of course.
Like, you know what, Martin? It's way more than 20 years ago, bro.
It is more than 20 years ago.
I
remember that he wanted his cash.
Yeah.
And they wouldn't give him cash. They were going to give him a check.
They were going to give him a check, bro.
He goes, hey, if I don't get cash, he told the two promoters, I'm going to grab you and shove you up your brother's ass.
That's right, cocksuckers.
Hey, Martin.
Yeah.
Martin, do you remember, like, I mean, this got to be 20 plus years ago, bro. Do you remember me and you, we met these girls and we were, you know, you were making out with one? I mean, this was years ago.
When you were single.
All of a sudden, All of a sudden they leave, bro, because the girl was trying to tell me how to kiss, and I go, no one tells Pancho Villa how to kiss.
I'm fucking Pancho Villa. You don't tell me how to do that. And all of a sudden all the lights came on. What a fucking ghetto part is
that? You got mad at me, bro? You got mad? He was so mad because I cock-blocked Martin, you know, unintentionally. I was like, I'm sorry, bro. It's just that, you know, you can't tell Pancho Villa how to kiss.
Hilarious.
The best part is you're like, hey, but we still have all this beer, huh, bro?
Hell, bro.
I remember
we went to that guy's house, Willie, and he kept showing us his Harley Davidson, and he kept turning that shit on at 2 in the morning, bro.
Oh, that's a
Primacha,
the Primacha, bro. That's with my Primacha right there. Who that was a Stevie C.
I was me, Willie, and I don't know who else. We were trying to make money off people with Polaroids.
Polaroid pictures.
Oh, you were selling the Polaroids after
hell yeah,
show.
$10 each. Thought they were buying them.
Original NFTs, bro.
NFTs.
If you have one of those, we'll let you in free anyway.
Fuck.
Damn, that's bro, awesome.
Hey, back then, bro, we needed to eat the next day, you know, right? With the Polaroid money. We're okay, bro, we got money to have breakfast, man. It's on.
That's hey, bro, so... how about when we have Ruby Quintana on the show, bro? How about when we talked about that night that he went crazy with a lady and you were there, bro? He was choking her. And you said, where do I put mine, dog?
Yeah, hey, bro, you know what's weird about that guy? I guess he became a preacher. Did you hear about that?
Yeah, bro, he sells real estate now, too. Shout out to Ruben.
Oh.
He sells real estate?
Hey, bro, become preachers. They can sell real estate. They can sell cars. You go either way.
Fuck it.
Yeah, he's like Christian now, yeah.
He's a pastor.
Yeah, and his homies, his homie, we had him on a podcast too. He sells prep foods.
Byron?
Byron.
Chef.
He's a chef.
Oh, I didn't know that, man.
Yeah, bro, he sells meal preps. He sends them to you wherever you're at.
Go ahead.
Don't forget, people, we have a listener. Her name is Don't Trip, and she's still looking for a date for next week at one of my Ontario shows, so... If you want to go out with her, she got an extra ticket. Fans@FelipeWorld.com if interested. Hit us up. It's a veterana dog with long socks.
That's awesome.
You got to be up for it to handle her, bro. Like,
you got to be what?
Up for it to handle her. Like, she looks like she will fucking...
The real deal, Holyfield.
Like, she talks like one of those people, bro, that like... I remember one time when Willie Barcena was doing... I don't know. He was doing community service in the freeway. And he was there early, dog. Like early, dog. He was there with his paisas and his alcoholics. And there was a chola there, dog. And Willie goes, what's over that crazy looking chola? Oh, fool, I gave that bitch a sandwich. And she didn't even say thanks. She looked at me like I was supposed to give it to her.
Yeah, bro. Hey, I was doing community service. I got my DUI. And I told Felipe, because after I did after I was cleaning up the freeways, I went to pick up Felipe and I go, hey, bro, fucking Chola. She was all hungry and I gave her half my sandwich. And not even a thank you, bro. I was so pissed, man. It's just, you know, I had to tell Felipe, man, fuck this. And I got to steer tomorrow. Hey, bro, I got to tell you, man. Felipe, I got to tell you something I never told you, bro. Hey, and this is obscure, all right? Felipe.
What, bro?
You know that you and I have the same mania. Like, the same habit, bro, because I remember in the morning, sometimes I go pick you up. You know how you brush your teeth and you gag?
Yeah.
I do it too, bro. I just never wanted to tell you.
I don't even know why I do it, bro, but I think it's my dad to brush my teeth. Did your mom brush your teeth?
No. Hey, did you guys know this? Hey, Rizzo, did you know that about Felipe?
I think I've been in the hotel with you when you brush your teeth, and I do hear the, ah! I'm like, but to me, it's normal, because I remember, like hearing my mom in the room. But I hope
that choked by some dude. No, huh?
I hope it was a toothbrush.
Hold on there.
She brushes her teeth all the time.
I didn't know that was your mom, dog. Willie pops out.
I remember Willie telling me, because I used to tell my mom used to go party at Club Bahia. He was like, you know what? I think it might be your dad. You tell me that.
Hey, that club, man, that Club Bahia, that was where you go meet some señoras, bro. You
know, no señoras, bro.
Yeah, all you got to say is like, oh, I speak English, and they're like, ay, mira, you know.
All you got to say, yo juego por los dos años, este año, mi primer año.
I'm here to shave your legs.
So what's up, Martin? You doing Dodger Stadium or what?
You know what? As of now, yeah, I'm on the lineup for Dodger Stadium.
Bro. The biggest show ever. We were just talking about that, bro. Like, there's going to be a lot of money in bootleg shirts outside.
Oh, hell yeah, bro.
A lot of money to be made, dog, for people. Because that always happens during a concert. There's always somebody, Rolling Stones, Dodger crap, like the worst Dodger t-shirts outside for $5.
I regret not buying a Frida Kahlo Dodger shirt at the Grateful Dead concert. They were selling them outside. They were selling them on the bridge right there when you're getting off the freeway, and we didn't have any cash. And I was like, fuck. And I go, well, we'll find them. There's gonna be another one. Nope, hell no. And you never saw it again. But yeah, no. That it's the Netflix is a joke. You're in the you're at the Orpheum. Congratulations to you. And
Chappelle and Eric, the other fool at the Hollywood Bowl.
Right. Like, there's I don't know how many goddamn comics in the festival, and then they got Gabriel doing Dodger Stadium, which is.
That's like. We were talking about crazy, it, bro. Like, because I've been to Dodger Stadium to see the. I'm lying, dog. I was there to work.
Mm-hmm. Pavarotti.
To see the Rolling Stones, Kiss. Smashing Pumpkins, and Kiss, and the three tenors. And I'm thinking the stage is going to be. Center field pavilion.
I have no idea where the
center field pavilion, bro, with some seats, and then Megatron on top, and then everybody else. Behind home plate will be the general admission. Loud fucking fireworks, dog.
It's gonna be insane, dude.
It's fucking huge, bro. Man. Yeah,
huge.
Wild
Coyotes to that, forget about it, dog.
Crazy, bro.
That's
it's
insane.
Willie.
Tal Gordito, bro. Nothing but props, bro. You know, it's funny because I see people online. This is what I trip out on. I see a lot of Mexican Americans, bro, trying to protest Gordito. That because why is he doing it there? You know, that
Chavez Ravines, y'all, old shit.
That was like, yeah, 100 years ago.
Just fill up every Dodger game. And then this guy wants to do stand-up and you're going to talk shit? La verga.
There's a lot of militant people that... Look, what happened was atrocious, Raza.
Sanders should have shaved him, eh?
I razzed myself before you.
Atrocious.
But it was horrible. Right. It was horrible. But again, look.
It was the history, Martin.
But no. Listen.
It was benign.
Were these people displaced? Absolutely. But when you think about the Native Americans that got displaced out of the whole country, let's just just fucking protest America if that's what we're doing. That was a bigger displacement than any displacement in the history of fucking displacements. You know, so at some point, I go to Dodger games all the time, and you know who goes to Dodger games? A shit ton of Mexicans.
Yeah, nobody's sister goes there. My high school used to be a home plate, homie.
Nah, man.
This is where my grandma used to make her tortillas.
And listen, the people, like I said, they have a legitimate case. It's some freaking Native American somewhere. Hey, that was my grandpa's teepee over there where that goddamn Sears Tower is, you know?
Thought Arrowhead was.
Yeah, so you know, to those people that are angry, hey, you know what? It's your right to be angry. Keep on protesting that. But it's 2021, man. It's a whole different place.
My team. Mexicans, we can't protest too long. You know why? Because we got to go back to work, bro.
So, yeah, there's some people saying that shit. Pero at the end of the day, I think the majority of the people are happy. And you got to just look up and say, hey, fucking props to a brown dude that is achieving this level of success. Because that's a whole other place. Yeah.
Whole nother level, man.
Your man is outrageous.
Whole nother dimension, man.
Outrageous.
So y'all gonna take G. Riley or what?
I don't know who's in the
Save me a little backstage pass.
Who's doing catering?
For real, bro. Hey, bro.
Snaggletooth still around?
What's that?
Snaggletooth still around?
Snaggletooth? Who's Snaggletooth?
Right, y'all banging on New York now.
Who's Snaggletooth, bro?
I guess it's calling G. Riley Snaggletooth.
Oh, my God. I'll never forget, dog.
Those are tusks, bro.
That, I was supposed to go hang out with you guys
when the
Raiders went to the Super Bowl, but I was doing laundry. But I was getting fucked up at the laundromat right there by Rick's restaurant.
Uh-huh.
On Silver Lake?
Off the five?
Off the five right there, bro, the laundromat. And then I went to go see you guys, You guys were fucked up, bro. You
at Willie's house. At
Willie's house.
Yeah.
He got you guys a room.
Dude. Larry Omaha was there.
Fuck. Hey, bro, they lost. That's the Super Bowl they lost.
Yeah.
The center, remember? He went to TJ and partied?
Yeah.
Yeah, I threw everything away, bro. All that Raider shit I bought.
He said there was
Raider everything.
Raider mugs, dog. I think I have the Raider. I have one of the Raider mugs. I'm like, fuck that. I'll keep this shit.
Yeah, Raider karate suits.
This is an artifact. This is an artifact, dog.
Raider karate suits.
No, you threw a hell of a party, bro. It was awesome. Yeah, it was great.
Hey, you know the thing about me, and I don't know who said it, bro. I think you said it, Felipe. One of you guys said, like, when I invite you to my house, it's not an invitation, bro. It's kind of holding you hostage, you know?
It's the kidnapping, bro.
Because I don't let people leave. I'm that guy, bro. I'm like, bro, you're going to leave? And then, oh, bro, it's because my chick's telling me. You know, if you get that guy that says, my chick's calling me or my wife's calling me, you know, you start with the peer pressure, right? Like, come on, bro, don't be a pussy, man. Who wears the pants, man? Before you know it, we're fucking seeing the sun come up, man.
I'll make you a little bed of a couch.
You're Momo Rodriguez, bro. Momo Rodriguez was at Willie's house. We had him on a podcast.
The fuck out of my house.
And he said that Willie went to the bathroom to do something. And then Momo tells him off. He's stoned too or drunk. He goes, hey, Willie, I think I saw somebody pass by right now.
And then
Willie looked at him and said, bro, get the fuck out of my house.
Like, get your fat ass out of my house.
Yeah, don't you bring those fucking espantos here, bro. What the fuck?
You farted and that one came out, dog.
Hey. Hey, well, listen, bro. All right, I did do that. All right, I did.
No bad spirits, bro.
You had to walk to Long Beach, bro.
That was, you know, a couple of tequilas into it.
Oh, but, my God, that's funny.
That's the guy that didn't bring
anything.
You know
what I love about Momo, man? Momo's this way, bro. You could be talking to Momo at a comedy club, right? And you're talking about some deep shit, you know, about, oh, how's the road going, man? Road's going good. But he's always looking over your shoulder to see if there's a bigger name behind you, man. You ever notice that? I don't know if you guys noticed that, man.
You were looking for the director of Sons of Anarchy, bro.
He'll be at Dodger Stadium. Bro,
yeah, I was talking to him at the improv, and we're having like this deep conversation, and then all of a sudden, I see his eyeline, and he keeps going over my shoulder. I go, ooh, and then it was George Lopez walked in. Maybe and all of a sudden, he goes, all right, dog, good talking to you. In the middle of our conversation, bro.
Damn.
Maybe he was waiting for the famous elbow to fly.
You know what? Props to Momo, because in a relatively short time, he took himself and positioned himself in a great place right now.
Monumentally. I mean,
the dude's done.
Didactic, eh?
Hey,
he has positioned himself. You're right, bro. Even when we had Emilio Rivera, and he talked about Momo Rodriguez sneaking into the celebrity golf course, and like he could see that Emilio Rivera could tell that he snuck in there, bro, with a golf club. And he was telling Emilio Rivera what's up. And Emilio Rivera was like, nah, don't tell me what's up.
I'm going to tell on you, Holmes.
Like, it was uncomfortable for him, bro.
But you know what? Now he rolls with Emilio Rivera. Yeah. You know what I'm
Unfortunately,
saying?
Unfortunately,
Holmes. They were on Mayans. I mean, the dude has literally...
He did
a home invasion.
He did everything that someone else tried to do before us, but did it in a nice way, without borrowing money or burning people's cars. Eh?
The saga continues, it, the story ain't over, eh?
Remember when Willie had the Willie is a nice guy, bro. Bro, like people whatever, bro, but he left me his Mustang, bro. The Mustang?
Oh, I remember the Stanger. Stanger.
And I was driving with Philip. We thought we were badass.
Let's go to the beach.
I tried to close the what you call it, the
convertible, the top.
Yeah,
top?
In the freeway, dog. But yeah, I guess you can't close them in the freeway. I didn't know. On the projects, dog. So that shit slams back and crashes and breaks the side window. And then me and Philip feel glass in our necks, dog.
Just shattered.
Oh, fuck. I just got the car. I already broke the window. It hasn't been an hour yet. I got to pick this up at the airport tomorrow. I said, fuck. So I woke up in the morning, dog. I kept looking out the window, make sure nobody steals the car. And then, like, and if you're a man who lives in Los Angeles, in Boyle Heights, East LA, Lincoln Heights, and you've been in a lot of drama with women, and you book a lot of car windows, you know where to buy windows, eh?
Mission.
People have broken into your car. I went to Mission, bro. And
that dude with that big-ass stomach?
Yeah, big-ass panza with a little flag. Hey, I told him, tiene vidrios para Mustang, 1989. And he goes, see, way. And I went in there, bro, and he charged me like $170 to put the brand new window back in there all fine. and I picked this fool up late. But I did tell him, you know, it broke your window.
I thought he was going to say, oh, you cleaned the window, bro.
No, I was late. I was late picking you up. And I said, I'm sorry, man, but I broke your window. Hey, like bro, somebody else that burned the car.
Hey, bro, you know what? But you're at least better than Ernie G. Remember Ernie G?
Yeah.
You don't say bad words here, bro.
Okay. I'm fucking around. I loaned him my car, bro. You know, this is like the sneakiest shit ever.
Convertible Sebring, right?
He has it for 2 weeks. I go on the road. He has it for 2 weeks. And then I'm registering my car, right, when the registration comes up. And it says I have 12 parking tickets.
Oh, what? Shit.
And they were all Ernie G's. And he goes, bro, I don't know how I got that. I go, motherfucker, look at the parking ticket says your street, dude. And that cheap motherfucker never paid me, bro.
Damn.
That's Ernie G.
He could have paid your balloons, bro.
He wasn't telling you about the tickets? Like, they're going to, what the fuck?
Scandalous, dude.
Shit. Like, you're never going to find out.
I know, right?
Shout out to Ernie G.
Whoever you're scamming out there right now.
I never saw the tickets.
Beware. Himself.
He's out with balloons. He's out doing something with balloons right now, bro.
He pulled out the balloons, bro.
You know what? It's the holidays, eh? I don't want to talk shit about nobody.
I miss his roast.
Oh, wait till fucking January 1st, eh?
He did a roast?
No, when I was a young comic, you know, mm-hmm. I guess he would have Ernie G had a comedy roast at the Rumba Room, and I went. I don't know Willie went, but they roasted the fuck out of him, bro. I remember I opened up with, it's going to be hard for me to say this in front of his face because everything I'm going to say right now, I say behind his back.
Killed.
Hilarious.
Yeah, fuck yeah. Sheila Rivera was there. Her ugly-ass boyfriend at the time.
Oh, Sheila and Ernie did that, the Rumble Room together. That's right.
Hell yeah, bro. So
that's how it started out, right? And then it became his room.
Yeah. It shows the NASA rocket scientist.
And you took, hey, this fool took over
the Rumble Room?
Gotham's and Wild Coyote, bro, when it turned to something else.
Oh, yeah. Me and Flacco took it over.
I think it was, bro.
In 2012. I think you came down. You came down. Joey Diaz came down. 2012. And then I remember me and Flacco, like, the first night was fucking packed. And then, like, it was a good show, and then me and him were like sitting next to each other, and the two girls were grinding on us, and we're like high fiving each other, like, it's gonna be like this every fucking week. And then, like, 2 weeks later, it just got slow, and they're just kicking us out, bro. They're like, hey, you guys gotta get out of here, man.
Hey, man, that place had its heyday, bro.
So he continued the saga? It was you?
Me and Flacco continued the saga for probably like 3 months.
And then some hipsters took it over, right?
I think they tried to do that, and it didn't work out, because, like, those hipsters, they don't know where they're at in that area, you know?
But yeah. You know who hit me up on online was the manager, bro, from Wild Coyote, from Tortillas, and Debbie. From Gotham, Debbie. Debbie. She keeps in touch, and she's like, oh, so-and-so was at the, you know, used to come to the Wild Coyote, and used to come to, like, she you know, obviously she remembers you, she remembers all the names that went through, and it's got to be a mind fuck for her, bro, because nobody was a big name back then, you know? Everybody was just coming to the fucking bar, drinking and chilling and just...
We get two tickets and 20 bucks.
Yeah, you know? And now, you know, she's looking at it like, oh, fuck, it's like seeing little kids that grew up. I mean, we weren't little kids, but it's like seeing little kids that grew up and went off and you know, now you see them all grown up doing things, and it totally, she's so como se dice, like, appreciative and humbled by it, and is always like sending a lot of love to everybody. And I don't, you know, tell you guys all the time, but she does send love to all you motherfuckers.
They have a restaurant in Long Beach, but on the pier.
Yes, by the Parker's Lighthouse.
Yes, exactly. I passed by there.
What the hell's the name of that place?
It's always busy too.
I can't remember the name of the place.
It's called Turtle Sam. I don't know.
No.
What's up, fool? You know, you ever like run into people, bro, like from back in the days that go to Wild Coyotes? I was there when you guys started, when you guys were shit, eh?
I made you guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was a dude.
I supported you guys.
You and your schooner.
That's what I was saying, bro. That's what I said 2 weeks ago, bro. Like, I should have started what the other comedian was talking about, Tumex. My NFT when I first started doing comedy. Oh, man. Like, if you would have invested in my career, the beginning, I would have been paying you right now. Like, if you would have gave me $20 for gas in 20 years, I would have had to know you $2,000 right now, bro. And if you would have given me fucking a hand job right now, back in the days, I would have been having you a baby right now, eh? You
know what I mean? A sperm sample?
What about you appreciate more than Bitcoin, Raza.
Man, but you know, I still think, bro, like, I don't get too many Christmas shows because of COVID, I guess. But when was the last time you did a corporate gig? And I know, and tell me if it was bad.
I've never done a good corporate gig.
Me neither, bro.
Yeah. No. I've never done a good corporate gig.
Like, I got fired. I did one for like Chevy or Ford.
Oh, bro.
And Austin, or Dallas, Fort Worth, bro. And they hated me, man. You know, I'm not a corporate guy.
Bro,
you know?
I'll tell you the last one. It was about maybe 3 years ago. And they hit us up talking about we want to book you and Hooter because we're big fans of the podcast. And it was like this this banquet, not for cops, but for a division of the police department. And they're like, oh, yeah. I go, hey, but, you know, I said, we're not going to be clean. It's like if this is corporate and you want clean, you don't want us. No. We just want you guys to be you. And I was like, all right, fuck it. So we go. The dude is all like, the guy that booked us is like, oh, yeah, we're going to party.
This guy.
He goes, I hope you guys don't fuck. I hope you guys didn't drive because we're going to get drunk today. And he's fucking giving us drinks y la chingada. Bro, I don't think I was up there for more than 15 minutes, bro. And they were fucking lighting me and scrambling.
What the fuck is this?
Like, bro, everybody was there with their wife.
This is pandemonium, man.
Everybody was there with their wife. And I'm Hooter's trying to get my attention. Like, hey, ya bájate, cabrón.
It was preordained.
Bro, I got off that. I'm like, well, I guess it's over. and I went over. That dude that was all like, hey, let's party. Let's party. Goes, hey, you know, one of the wives got, and I'm like, oh, fuck, hey, man, I told you. And I go, so we still took the check, it cleared. But yeah, no, I'm not a big fan of anything.
Hey, bro, like that. Check this out. Hey, who's that rock star that wears a bandana and he had a show on VH1 called something of the Love of Rock?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Bret Michaels.
Bret Michaels.
Rocking the Love.
Bret Michaels. So check this out, bro. About 6-7 years ago, my agent calls me and says, hey, man, the band that was going to open up for Bret Michaels bailed. And you want to do the gig? I go, yeah, man, I'll do it. I'm not doing nothing. So it was up in Riverside. I went up to the Fox Theater in Riverside. And I asked the manager, right? I go, what kind of comedy do you want me to do? And he goes, bro, this is rock and roll. Rock out with your cock out. I go, are you sure? He goes, yeah, man, this is rock and roll, dude. I go, all right. So I go out there, bro, and I tell jokes about vagina and dicks and fucking and just, I just went fucking rock and roll, bro. Nobody laughed at nothing. And they took me out of there in 10 minutes too, bro. And then they turned on the lights, right? Bro, all the moms that I guess liked the band back when he was young are there with their daughters, bro.
Oh my God.
I'm talking little girls. I'm talking like, you know, kids. And I was like, holy. I go, dude, it's your fault, man. You told me to rock out with my cock out.
Bro. But you know what, Willie? That's a really good point, bro. Because I went to a I went to go see Iron Maiden. I think it was 2007 at the Forum, right? And they hadn't toured in a while, and it was like I went to the show. I fucking had a bunch of joints. I'm fucking chilling there. My homie's there. And I light up a joint and I'm like, yo, and I pass it. And then he's like telling me, like, he's shaking his head. Like, he's all scared, right? And I'm like, what the fuck? And then I realized he had brought his two teenage daughters with him.
Oh,
and so, but you're at a goddamn concert. What do you, like, that's what you do at concerts.
But
you
I'm know? Wearing like, New Balance, dog.
Like, get the fuck out of here, man. Like, I'm not going to not smoke a joint because you brought your punk ass kids. Like, you know.
Yeah, man.
Like, hey.
You never been to a Willie show?
Come on.
You never been 21? He gets you fucked up on stage in front of your dad.
That was all that status.
It's crazy, but it has become that where people do bring their kids to see the bands that they used to come and wild out to. And the fact that they used to wild out, but now they don't want to wild out and pretend that they never wilded out. Like, you hypocrite motherfucker,
bro,
man.
Like, bro, it's like if you go see the Rolling Stones, man. They're most of those people are great grandparents now. Not only grandparents, great grandparents. You know?
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
My show last week, bro, at the we did two shows in San Antonio, and right in the front row on the second show, there was a man that was laughing at every other dirty shit. Then I started noticing, okay, who are these fools next to them? Like, by the end of the show, for an 11-year-old kid and a 14-year-old. And they were listening to pussy dicks from the other comedians, dog. They're like, funny, your dad don't care about that shit, huh? Fuck it, huh? Then I said, you ever caught your mom and dad having sex? How are you? They see you guys there. They see your little fingers under the door. And then that guy said,
you heard your mama.
Then yeah, for real. Then I told that fool, like, what I told that kid, that little 14-year-old, hey, bro, when you turn 19, bro, you're going to meet a woman with 3 kids, and your mom's going to try to cock block you, bro, right? Listen to my words. Don't turn down the best blowjob of your life. Your mom's going to tell you shit like, está ponchada. She's not good for you. Of course she's not, but she's good for a little while.
Hey, she was good 3 times, bro.
hey, the kid's in therapy right now, bro.
I mean, Target practice, bro. We were the best. You know how you fuck. There was a dude heckling, bro, Willie, the whole time, bro. Like, right, and everybody was fucking with that dude, right? Bah, 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 bah. And then Willie came from the Irvine Improv, you know, doing a big show Wednesday night. But he was like the, but everybody was making fun of this comedian, this idiot, the front row, right? He was angry. And he goes, bro. And then Willie looks at him, bro, I'm not going to make fun of you, dog. I know you, dog. I know what you are, bro. You know, after this is over, Ray, you're going to go home, dog. And you're going to reflect, dog. You're going to put your hat on your head, bro. He goes, fuck, hey, I'm a loser, Ray. Fool, everybody died, dog. Die, yeah, bro.
I remember that, bro. There was a heckler.
He was like a Rambo fool, right? Like a Rambo fool.
A fucking commando, eh?
Yeah, dog, like a commando dude. But then I do end up getting loaded with Willie. And then they went.
It got dark. Hey, Felipe, remember this? I said, look, bro, you're going to get so depressed, you're going to want to kill yourself. But don't do it, dude. I'm here for you.
Yeah, it was fucked up, bro.
Damn,
bro, there was time Willie was being heckled by this old man. And he fucked that fool up, bro. He said, bro, what are you doing right here, dog? You should be with your grandkids hugging them, bro. You should be over there baking cookies. They're probably crying right now. When did grandpa leave our man?
Fucking hey, bro.
You know, hey, bro, that Wednesday night, my opening line, and it I kind of used it. I said it too many times. But yeah. That opening line on Wednesday is full of those, because a bunch of hot chicks used to show up. And I remember I used to go, all right, Wednesday night, how many women here are proud moms? And you would hear like everybody, a bunch of women bro. Clap. And I'd go, hey, go home and take care of your kids, you fucking bitches.
Hey, bro, remember when you were hanging out with some crazy motherfucker from El Salvador, I think his name was Jose, at a Daily Planet, and they stole his watch, and then those girls showed up the next week with his watch. They were wearing it.
Yeah.
Gangsters.
Bro, that girl hit me up, the one that stole the watch, or some crazy ass chick that said, you nutted in me. But anyways, she was there. And, she fucking, I hit her up, right? She hit me up. He goes, you remember me back in the days of Daily Planet? And like, she's still like a fox, right? But she's older now. She goes, yeah, I think you showed up with a fake ID, right? I remember you. He goes, yeah, and I think your friend stole that watch. She still said, fuck that fool.
He doesn't even know what time it is.
And then, because I remember when Willie told him, hey, man, I fucked up. You guys took that guy's watch from the stage. The girl said, fuck that fool. He was bragging and shit, showing it off. That's why we took it. Shut up about it.
Yo, you know what they did to him, bro? They took him to a hotel, and they got him pedo, and they just jacked all his shit, bro. And the next day, he told me that they did that. So that's when I saw him again the following week. I go, hey, you guys, come back his watch, man. That's fucked up.
Yeah. Bro, I ended up seeing that guy worked as a pharmacist at a drugstore, right? And I never seen him since that day. But then I ran into him at Wild Coyotes when Willie was in Sacramento already. And he goes, Felipe, I'm sorry that if I have a bad memory of you, that's all I remember. I said, bro, yeah, you the guy with the watch. They stole it from you. He goes, yeah, dude, that dude and I, we partied from Wednesday night till Monday in the morning, bro, doing blow and Xanax, dog. Like, I had saliva. I was driving his fucking Range Rover to Whittier and back to buy alcohol, vodka, and cranberry juice.
Bro, Bonaducci style.
Him and I, we partied so hard, he had to call his homies, because I think he does it all the time. So after 5 days, they go wake him up and snap him out of it, bro. So they were like, snap him out of it. They put him in the shower. And then those dudes gave me a ride home. No. They called Lisa, and Lisa picked me up. And I was full of saliva, bro. But luckily, yeah, I think he went back to El Salvador, and he sobered up. He went to my show. He's clean.
God so damn, a five-day run.
Bro, it was crazy, Willie. It was crazy. Like I like to party, dog.
Did you sleep at all?
Yeah.
No, dog. No sleep to Brooklyn.
Is that the longest you partied?
Yeah, man. And, like, it was, bro, I had, like, saliva, dog. Like, we would hit a bump and then do Xanax to stay alive, you know?
Yeah. Fucking scientific, dude, doggy.
We had a homie named Candyman, and that fool bought dope from somebody, and, like, fuck, eh? Like, we opened it up, and then somebody put 2 nickels inside of it to make it heavier, eh?
Now you got an ounce.
We didn't care. What's up, Willie Barcena, Martin Moreno?
What's up, dog?
My bro, I'm telling you, bro, that line you told Willie Martin Moreno in San Jose, you're not ready, bro. I brought you too soon. People who don't even know you guys say that line.
Yeah.
It's not your fault, bro.
Bro, Willie, before you go, bro, did you still wrestle people in San Jose?
No, bro. I don't think I've wrestled in about 2 years.
This was in 2 years.
You gotta make your comeback, bro.
I just wrestle with my demons now, dog.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Martin Moreno.
Yeah, man.
Willie Barcena. Go check him out, the Stratosphere. And what's your Instagram?
At Willie Barcena, bro.
And also, bro, your TikTok is blowing up, bro. You some of your videos have millions of views.
Thanks to you, bro. I appreciate you, man. Nah, I appreciate the love.
You had a million views before me.
Going viral,
no, bro, but
dude.
You know what? I have to give credit where credit's due, bro. But I had a show in Burbank, and
sold out.
Some of your peeps, man, a lot of your peeps showed up, and it's talking about they went because of you, bro. So I want to give you love and say thank you, man.
But they're all over you, bro, hugging you like they act like they know you, huh? Weird, huh?
yeah.
Podcast fans are great because they hold you like. They want to talk about episode 200.
you got to think about it, man. They listen to all the personal stories, so they're like, dude, this is my homie, you know?
Yeah, and Willie, I mean, people have been saying, and then Willie did this, and Willie did this, and Willie did that. You know, you're a fucking legend, homie. You're a walking legend.
When that happened to you, bro, at the Mexican village in El Paso, I don't give a fuck, bro. I put up a tweet. Who are you, Team Willie or Team Other Guy? Bro, you have 79%, bro. You won.
The swing voters.
Jay Moore. Oh, come here, Butch. Come here. We have somebody wants to say hi to you. Right here. Yeah.
What's up,
right
bro?
Here, right here, bro. Yeah. What up, Willie?
What's up, Butch?
I can't hear you, but I love you, man. Oh, shit. What up, Willie?
I love you, bro. I always love working with you.
What's that?
I said, I always love working with you,
hell
man.
Yeah,
you
I
great
love working
fun.
With this fool, man. This fool taught me hella stuff, how to write, took me on the road, man. Like, this is one of my favorite human beings, man.
Love you, bro. I love you, Butch.
And fuck the other guy.
Bro.
Oh, shit.
Hey, Felipe.
Yeah, bro.
Felipe.
What?
I got to tell you about Butch, the way I met him. You know, because you know some of the stories about me, bros. Okay, a lot of them are true.
Yeah.
Okay, but some of them are a little exaggerated.
Embellished.
I met Butch. He was wearing a biker jacket. He was wearing a bandana. He was looking angry as fuck, bro. And I'm like, what's wrong with this guy, right? So I go, hey, bro, I'm Willie. And he goes, yeah, I know who you are. I go, all right, man, what's your name, man? I'm Butch. Hey, nice to meet you. And then, that, like, the cold shoulder, bros, go, what the fuck's up with this guy? And then we do the show, we have some beers, and he tells me, damn, bro, I always hear that you're a dick, man. I go, pretty cool.
What's so anyway, up, dude? Shout out to Willie Barcena. Go check him out, the Stratosphere. And Martin Moreno, the Yo, 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 Yo podcast.
Just 3 O's.
3 O's.
Yo, yo, yo.
Give you an extra one. What up, bro? And right now, man, stay tuned. We're going to show
Two Mix.
And we're going to show a clip, a little Christmas clip for everybody. Check it out if you want to look at it too, Willie.
All right, bro.
We love you, man. Thanks for being on the show.
Merry Christmas. Thanks, Happy bro. New
Merry
Year.
Merry Christmas.
Quiero que sepas la verdad. No te he dejado de adorar. Allá en mi triste soledad me han dado ganas de gritar, salir corriendo y preguntar qué es lo que ha sido de tu vida. Acá entre nos siempre te voy a recordar. Y hoy que a mi lado ya no estás, no queda más que confesar que ya no puedo soportar, que estoy odiando sin odiar, porque respiro por la herida. Acá entre nos, quiero que sepas la verdad. No te he dejado de adorar. Allá en mi triste soledad me han dado ganas de gritar, salir corriendo y preguntar qué es lo que ha sido de tu vida. Acá entre nos, siempre te voy a recordar. Y hoy que a mi lado ya no estás, no queda más que confesar que ya no puedo soportar, que estoy odiando sin odiar, porque respiro por la herida.
Dude, his name was Santa Claus, you know, and he used to live over there in the projects, Pico Aliso, with his old lady, and they had a pretty good thing together because his old lady was really fine, and they, you know, and like she used to make these the best brownies in town, man, and oh man, I could remember them like I could eat one of them like right now.
Man, you knew these people, bro?
Oh yeah, man, they used to live next door to me, man, until they got kicked out, man.
They got kicked out of the projects, dude?
Yeah, you know what happened, man. They used to live with these little midges, you know, these little persons. And you know, and the midges used to make a lot of noise, man. Like, ka, 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 ka. Pounding and hammering and pounding all night, man.
Oh, yeah. Typical freaks, bro.
Oh, yeah, man. They were really fucking freaks, man. As a matter of fact, they all moved up north together, man. Like, really far, like, past Fresno.
Oh, like. They had to get their head together, huh?
Oh, yeah, man. They had to get their head together. You know, they started a commune, you know, and it was called the Santa Claus and Old Lady Commune. It was a real famous one up there, man. They used to sit around and groove all the time, you know. And,
oh, yeah?
Yeah. a really good time, man.
That sounds heavy, dude.
Hell yeah, man. And they would eat these brownies, man, and drink the tea, man, and... And what they did most of the time, though, was they make a lot of goodies, you know, and they had everything they needed. They only needed to come into town maybe once a year or something like that.
To pick up the welfare check and the food stamps, right?
Yeah. No. What they did, man, is that once a year, when they made all the goodies, you know, they used to put them in a big shopping bag, and then they used to take the shopping bag and give them to all the boys and girls around the world, man.
That sounds badass, bro.
Oh, like, yeah, man. They were really nice people and so much class, man. They had so much class, you know, like even take the way they used to deliver the toys, you know. It's like Santa Claus used to have this really sharp short, you know, the little old school 40 cars. Man, you know, it was lowered to the ground, had twice pipes, candy apple red and a button top. Ooh, clean.
That's a badass snowmobile, bro.
No, it was not a snowmobile. It was a sled, you know, one of those big sleds, you know, and he used to have it pulled by these reindeers, you know, like reindeers.
Some what, man?
Some reindeers, man. He used to find them over there at Home Depot, you know, and he used to hook them onto the sled, and he used to stand up inside the sled and hold on to the reins and then call out their name like, I'm Donner, I'm Blitzen, I'm Chewy, I'm Tavo, come on, Beto. And then the reindeer used to take off into the sky and fly across, right, man?
Wow, man, that is far out, man.
Yeah, and then when they fly across the sky, they used to come down to the places like, oh, Chicago, L.A., Nueva York, and Pacoima, and all those places, you know, and then land on top of people's roofs, and Santa Claus would make himself real small, you know, like real small guy, and he'd come down a chimney, and then he would give you the stuff that he made, and dig this, man. He did it all in one fucking night.
Hey, just a minute, man. Now, how'd he do that?
Oh, well, man, he took the freeway, man, the 605. What else, man?
No, man. How'd he do all that other stuff? Like, how'd he make himself small, man? And how'd he, like, go get the reindeer off the ground, man?
Oh, man, he has some magic dust, man.
Oh, some magic dust.
Oh, yeah, man, magic dust, man. He used to give a little bit to the reindeer, a little bit to Santa Claus, a little bit more to Santa Claus. A little bit more for Santa Claus.
And this would get the reindeer off.
Oh, it got them off, man. Are you kidding me, man? They flew all the way around the world, man.
Dude, that's far out, bro. Hey, how come I've never met this dude?
Oh, man, he doesn't do that bit anymore, man. It got too dangerous, man.
Yeah, I can dig that, bro, because that's a dangerous bit, man.
Oh, yeah, man. Let me tell you, for sure it was, man. Like, just 2 years ago, man, he got stopped at the border, you know, and they took him into another room, and they took off his clothes, man, and searched him, and they searched his bag of goodies, man. And then when he was leaving, man, he was flying through the air, and somebody took a shot at him, man, reindeers, man.
You know? That's a drag.
Yeah, it really was. And then, man, he was down south, man. They tried to cut off his hair and his beard, man. And all the time, he was getting stopped and pulled over and asked for his ID, man. Just everywhere he went, he ran into too much recession, man.
No, man, you mean he ran into too much repression, man.
Oh, repression, recession, man, is the same thing, man.
Yeah, man, but it's a drag, man, because we sure could use a dude like that right about now.
Oh, he still comes around, man.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, but he's like in a disguise now, man.
Ah, he went underground.
Yeah, man, but you also see this underground, man, yeah.
Oh, I can dig it, bro.
Yeah, but you also see this guy, man. Like, nobody would ever know it was him.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, he got a job in front of the department store, in front of Food for Less, ringing this bell and playing this tambourine next to his black pot, you know.
Oh, I seen that dude, bro.
Yeah, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, dude, I played with that dude last year, man.
What?
Yeah, we played in front of a store, man. We made a lot of bread, bro.
Oh, man, wait a minute, man. Santa Claus is not a musician.
Oh, I'm hip, man. That cat didn't know any tunes, bro.
Oh, wait a minute, man. No. He's not hip to all that, man. No.
No, I played with this dude, man.
Are you sure, man?
Positive.
Oh, man. Merry Christmas, people.
Feliz Navidad.
Feliz Navidad. We got two bags now. That was awesome, bro.
What's going down? Two bags. You got those people right here. All my cheese people. Hey, real talk. Felipe paid me two big in tamales. He told me to come test my the pizza logo. Six niggas rap. Secret City, the underground hip hop. Platform collection. Let's go. It's 2021, we're still trying to solve these jigsaws. I'm gonna go to the doctor, cut off my leg with a jigsaw. And I'm still here trying to carry you up this hill in the rickshaw. It took the cop to kill Nipsey for you to go visit Crenshaw. Run avenge your death, knowledge yourself and then some. These whack rappers are holding yourself for ransom. And that's what make me wanna go vegan and all the carnage. I feel dead inside, but all the DJs, I still love good music and are forced to play all of the garbage. I swear to God, motherfucker, that we've been set up. Our love is stronger than your hate, there is no time to let up. People always ask me why the visionaries couldn't put it together and blow up just like Kendrick. Maybe it's being an independent, or maybe it's not bullshit. We don't have to be logical, Russ, motherfucker, cause we're just loud. Of Mexican descent, visionary crew, shapeshifters. Like Brexel from the shapeshifters on the track. That's right.
Platform Collection, Good Life Project Flow. Shout out to Chobolancico, T-Ski, Get Better. Let's go. Yo. Yo. Yo soy el chavo del ocho. You're in a rambling sideshow. Reveling in your own benevolence. You're not good at handling this. Word nervous, the word service. Can no longer serve purpose on the earth's surface. I got my nanogram all up to myself. Rearranging letters, ever-changing weather. Mutilating Heather like if I was Christian Slater. I got my Christianity debater. Every denomination is dominated by demons. The deacons of pastor. Floating in alabaster disaster. Faster pussy cat as a rock thief. Is where actors with moxie jockey. Assalamu alaikum. I also like the Lakers. Los Angeles underground hip hop monster maker. Chronic Ronnie Baker. Lethargic archer earth. Parchment martial arts. Enemy to starch. Rather die. That's right. What's up, fool? Tumex, OMD, Visionaries, we got my man Kill C-Ray, Hip Hop Eddie in the house, D-Ski Get Better, Secret Saviors of Underground Hip Hop, All Day LA Underground Hip Hop. That's right, make some noise y'all, it's my first song, make some noise y'all. Shout out to Life Breaks Up for flipping that pot of cheese for me. He flipped that first pot of cheese jam for me right there. You gonna keep that beat playing? You gonna keep that beat playing? What's up, man? Let's go. Let's go. Oh yeah, I got my hit. I got my backup dancers. Tumex with Felipe, yo, we not tripping, it's Christmas time. Yo, we came to do this every single time. With Mexican descent on the rhyme. With all of the homies, what's up, fool? Tumex, the OMD, Project Blood Crew. We always know what to do. Los Angeles, home of that scandalous. Born in East LA, you know what to do. Tumex, we got that all day, and day, and... Oh, make some noise, y'all. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, oh, man, I got hammer dancers. I got hammer dancers on this last one. All right, we got one more. Let's do this, man. I got some hammer dancers.
I want you to tell
Let's
you
go. Yes, 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 yes. Of Mexican descent. Yo, if you don't know about my music, check it out. Tumex.bandcamp. Educate yourself. Yo, listen, yo. Sometimes I make things real hard for me. I'm a work in progress, I am art for me. My life is more bittersweet than it's heartwarming. Never listen to the diagram and the chart warning. My homie circus hits me with the paranoia. I'm starting to think that he's really just a clairvoyant. I never listen to the voices when they answer back. Used to wanna be Jim Morrison and Jack Kerouac. But now I see my homie's face when he's looking back. I don't wanna go extinct like a pterodactyl. Sometimes I meet a woman and we know ourselves. As we slip into darkness, destroy ourselves. I lose it, I wake up in the morning and reboot it. Where did Joe Hoss, Mr. Brady, keep it deep-rooted? Happy motherfuckers here, I just see through. Even if I'm not rich, my influence is see-fluid. I can't sleep through it. I need to see the dawn. I need to see the orange sky wash away my wrongs. My life's a sing-along, but you don't know the lyrics. I'm trying to tell you something, but you don't want to hear it. I'm a sensationalist. I spiritually slip my wrist. This is not a song as much as it's a list. Yo, take the risk. Yo, I burn 1,000 bridges and I have to paddle through the debris of bad decisions. I love indecision. I love disinformation. I used to shroom to the cure of disintegration. In my wallet, got my house keys, car keys, photo ID, might as well have an IV. Getting better than my arm, got me bugged out. Sometimes I'm like, fuck this planet, I wanna log out. I vlog out on a thought that is perverted. I reword it, I repackage it up and I curb serve it. Iceman, King Parsons, George Gervin. I'm on a frequency that is unnerving. I love hurting, I love my back against the wall. Take it back to Annie Hall, take it back to writing walls. I let you make the call, I let you flip the coin. It doesn't matter, heads or tails, addicted to the toy. All about the process, take a loss, yes. Always on point like a mentalist, yo. Yes, yes, fucking mental illness to the check, yes, yes. Fucking mid-city to the chest, yes, yes. Pyramid city to the chest. Tumex and cycle rim still coming up next. Yes, yes. Fucking mental illness to the chest, yes, yes. Fucking mid-city to the chest, yes, yes. Pyramid city to the chest. That's right. Yes, yes. Los Angeles fresh. Los Angeles fresh. Yes, yes, yes.
Los Angeles fresh. Los Angeles fresh, yo, yo. Don't be mad because my dance card's always punch. Rosario Dawson, Toronto Lake's gonna take me to lunch. You see my name's two mix from the groundbreaking group called of Mexican descent. With Choron Cinco, we throw a better song than your single. Probably dated your girl when she was single. See, we just been in the lab. We're still the dopest Mexican MCs that Los Angeles really has. These other fools are fugazi and really ass. You wanna know about the dope shit that really gas. The new world order is also nightmare on Elm Street type dude. I'm still bumping Psycho Rome and Shit Platoon. I'm not getting treated like a platoon. I'm about to level the boom. Hit you slower than some shrooms on some grandmother phone. Throw a dollar in the sky, cause the change comes soon, yo. It might even pop off next week. I see some bomb ass freaks flipping Immortal Technique. It's two mix, y'all. What's up, bro? Much love. You're looking out. What's up, everybody? Thank you, everybody, who came out tonight. Mati Moreno, Rodrigo Torres, Martin Rizzo, Butch Escobar, made the trip. Philip, two mix right here. James, right there. Chile. What's up, everybody? Merry Christmas. Yeah.